Good morning, YouTube. Last summer, I made a video discussing the economics of third-party natural gas suppliers. You can find a link to that video in the upper right-hand corner here and in the video description. And from that analysis, I determined that it was best for me to go back to purchasing gas from my local utility instead of a third party. So the reason for this video is that I've learned some additional information that needs to be considered. So here's my current natural gas bill from the utility website. You can see I have nearly a $29 credit after the gas charge last month. The note at the top refers to a California Climate Credit Adjustment. So the link in that note takes me to the CPUC, or California Public Utility Commission, Climate Credit page. It mentions a state program requiring utilities to buy carbon pollution permits. In other places, these are called greenhouse gas allowances or credits. And it says that this climate credit represents utility ratepayers' share of the payments from the state's program. And this credit only applies to gas customers of these four largest investor-owned public utilities listed here. I missed out on prior year's credit payments because I was purchasing gas from a third-party supplier and not the utility. I had heard public service announcements about this on the radio over the last few years, but never saw anything on my bill. So bottom line is you need to consider these credit payments as an additional cost of using a third-party gas supplier. In my case, that's roughly $30 a year or $2.50 a month. Not a big deal, but add that to the $5 per month customer charge I was paying, and that adds up. And again, you can check out the earlier video for the detailed analysis. Now, the remainder of this video will be learning a bit more about this climate credit. Why does the credit amount vary by utility? Here, it mentions that the credit is determined by how many greenhouse gas allowances are sold and how many customers are splitting the money. And how is the credit amount calculated? So the utility receives proceeds from greenhouse gas allowance auctions. Each utility divides all available funds equally among its residential customers. So this is about as clear as mud. One line says the utilities have to buy permits, and another place it says they divide the proceeds among customers. Here is a link in the small business paragraph that sheds a bit of light on the subject. So it's a PDF file here. So this PDF file has the small business greenhouse gas allowance calculations. Here on page 2, it mentions the California Air Resources Board, abbreviated ARB or sometimes CARB, CARB, and the cap and trade regulation. And then it says investor-owned utilities are granted free allocation of greenhouse gas allowances, which they are required to sell. And if we scroll down here, there's various tables in this document. There's this one. Down at the end of the document are a couple of tables showing several assistance factors. And I'm unsure of which one is actually being used, but remember this general idea, it'll come up later. So you had full assistance here, 100% assistance in 2013, and that declines over time until about 2020. Like I say, there's various tables with various numbers, but that's the general idea, is this is a phased program. This is classic. Here's one government program, cap and trade, and then you need to set up a separate program, climate credit, to deal with the consequences of the first. So what's this cap and trade regulation, and what does it have to do with climate credits? Here's a page on the PUC websites that talks about the cap and trade program. So this is an incentive type program. We'll see more of this later. CAP refers to capping greenhouse gas emissions at some level that declines over time through use of these permits, credits, allowances, whatever you want to call them. And then the trade part refers to being able to trade, buy, and sell these allowances. So California Climate Credit and funds to protect customers. Some of that money is used by the state to fight climate change, and some goes to customers. So here's the ARB Cap and Trade website if you want some light reading. I'll leave a link to all these pages in the video description if you want to dig in some more. So while there's lots of stuff here, I didn't find much of interest, but I found this page has an excellent summary. This is the Center for Climate and Energy Solutions. So here they have the California greenhouse gas emissions by sector in 2015. And then here's a little chart. This line here would be what the greenhouse gas emissions would be with no controls. And then the green is the cap. And then these are various offsets that have been done out of the state, in the state, and showing those projections over time. But down here, they have a really excellent summary, cap and trade details. So the cap and trade program started as a state assembly bill in 2006, and it was implemented by the ARB finally in 2011, and then it's been extended through 2030, apparently. So here it says applies to sources of 25,000 or more tons of CO2 or equivalent per year. There's six main greenhouse gases plus a few extra. And here you've got CO2, here's methane. So methane is kind of interesting because it's a greenhouse gas in itself if it leaks. And then if you burn it to, say, produce heat or electricity, it turns into carbon dioxide. So all of these gases, I guess, are handled slightly different. They all have different effects. Here's sulfur hexafluoride, which is used in high voltage switchgear by electrical utilities. So let's see, down here, phase one applied to electricity generation, including imports and industrial sources that emit 25,000 metric tons or more CO2. And then in 2015, they added petroleum and natural gas distribution. Emission allowances are distributed by a mix of free allocation and quarterly auctions. So here, free allowances, investor-owned utilities must sell these and distribute funds to customers. And the free allowances decline over time. Other allowances must be purchased at auctions. And we saw that in the PDF file earlier. So I still don't understand this fully. Say the state gives or sells the utility a permit to emit X tons of CO2, and then the utility emits X tons of CO2. What happens to that permit or allowance? I would think at that point, the permit would either be handed back to the state or filed away someplace. It's been used. If so, what is the utility selling? So are these allowances in excess of what they require? Or do they sell the free allowances and then buy back what they actually need at the auction? Or are they saying it's proceeds from the utilities purchasing the additional allowances from the state? Some of the PUC information leans this way, saying the state is giving the proceeds to the utilities to give to the customer as climate credits on their bill. Whatever the reason is, the idea is that it's an easy way to get funds back to utility customers, a credit on their bill. And it might encourage customers to apply those funds to adding weather stripping, caulking, pipe insulation, etc., to help cut gas consumption going forward. At least this is what some of the PSA spots on the radio mentioned. Here's an article from the LA Times that has some good information. This mentions that greenhouse gas emissions have fallen faster than anticipated due to reductions in electric generation emissions and electric cars. So maybe that's why there are excess allowances that can be sold. And there's a similar table to the one that was on the previous website. It also hints at a surplus of allowances that may be used in the future, causing emissions to rise. So here's the annual caps, and here's the actual emissions. What they're saying is that these excess allowances might be used in the future, and you'll end up with more emissions actually than the target. Anyway, here's some more information back on the Center for Climate and Energy Solutions website. And down here it talks about offsets or protocols. So these are mitigations that may be used in place of buying permits or allowances. So protocols currently exist for forestry, planting trees, dairy digesters, ozone depleting substance projects, mine methane capture, rice cultivation. Offset projects may be located anywhere in the U.S. Anyway, remember this. I'll mention it again in the next video where I take a look at a somewhat shady third-party natural gas supplier. I'm not sure, but these offsets may also include utility-sponsored energy conservation programs like insulation and Energy Star rebates. So if anyone has anything to add to help clarify any of this, please post up in the comment section below. And as always, thanks for watching.